My young friends, the names will keep on coming to mind. The excellence will keep on coming to mind. The virtues will keep on coming to mind. The contributions these people made will keep on coming to mind. These were indeed the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These were indeed the followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They elevated the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah in every corner of the globe. Wherever these people went, because of their worth, because of their caliber, because of their what they had achieved, all of a sudden people were now interested in Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. People all of a sudden were interested in Islam. People all of a sudden were interested in the Quran. Why, my young friends? Because these people were no losers. These people, they believed in وَالصَّابِقُونَ السَّابِقُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ الْمُكَرَّبُونَ. They were the foremost. They believed those that are foremost in this world, they will be the foremost in the next world. They are the ones that will be near to Allah. And as a result, صَارِوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. There was no such thing as walking to paradise. For these people, it was all about striving and sacrificing and running to paradise and performing the deeds. وَلَا تَحِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. And as a result, there was no such thing as an inferiority complex. There was no such thing as weakness. أَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ. They believed in superiority and they led and they were superior. وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةِ وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنَ. And they strive and they sacrifice because they knew those that strive and sacrifice, their striving and their sacrifice will be appreciated by their master. And for this, they sacrifice everything they possess. They sacrifice their time. They sacrifice their wealth. They sacrifice their properties. They sacrifice their life to elevate the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, overcoming every obstacle that came their way. A fire burned in their hearts, and this fire that was burning in their hearts did not let them rest till they excelled, till they elevated the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah in every corner of the globe. My friends, look at their determination, look at their zeal, look at their thirst in when it came to any aspect of the deen. When it came to any aspect of the deen, look at their himmat and their sacrifice and their zeal. When it came to reciting the Quran, the very book which you and I have forgotten what it looks like, it's in our drawers covered with dust. My friends, when it came to the book of Allah, such was the zeal that you had the ummatis of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam who would recite the entire Quran in 7 days. Entire Quran in 7 days. My friends, and they were number in their thousands. They were number in their thousands. They had businesses like you and I had. They had children like you and I had. They would provide for their families just like you and I do. But in spite of this, they would recite the entire Quran in 7 days. There were those for whom even 7 days were too much, and they would recite the entire Quran in 3 days. Entire Quran in 3 days. You know, for you and I, you know, we become puzzled. Why? Because how can a person recite a Quran in 3 days and also work? Because we make qiyas upon ourselves. We look at ourselves and we find, hey, look, it takes us, you know, just to recite a page of the Quran, it takes us 5-10 minutes. So how is it possible for this person to work and at the same time be able to recite the Quran? In three days he would finish the entire Quran. It was passion. It was love for the words of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Balki even 3 days is so much. There were ummatis from the ummat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that would recite the entire Quran in 1 day. 1 day, and they number in their hundreds. For some, even 1 day was too much. And the likes of Ali al-Azdi would come at the time of Maghrib, and he would open the book of Allah in the masjid, and he would begin, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. He's now speaking with his creator, and he would not stand up from his place till he read, Qul a'udhu bi Rabbin Nas, Malikin Nas, Ilahin Nas, Min Sharil Waswasil Khannas, Alladhi Yuwaswisu Fi Sudurin Nas, Min Al-Jinnati Wan Nas. And after this, he would offer his Isha prayer and then return home. There were ummatis of Rasulullah for whom even this was nothing. And they would come after a hard day's work. whether it was on the fields, whether it was in business, or whatever it may be, after a hard day's work providing for their family, during the night they would come in the masjid or in their homes, and they would begin Allahu Akbar, and they would begin their prayer, and they would not go into ruku till they read the entire Quran in one rakat. Entire Quran. Uthman ibn Affan would do this. Tamim Idari radiallahu ta'ala would do this. Imam Bukhari would do this. Imam al-Shafi would do this. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi would do this. Waqi ibn al-Jarrah would do this. And then there were people even rare. They would finish the entire Quran 3 times in one day. Salim ibn Idr, the Qadi of Egypt, he would finish the Quran, so passionate he was, and so much intoxicated he was with the words of Allah, that he would recite the Quran 3 times in one day. And when they would leave this world, you would see the effect of the Quran on their faces, and you would see the effect and impact the Quran had on their hearts when they left this world. Maulana was saying that the youngster was smiling. When Abu Ja'far al-Qari died, on his heart they saw a circle of light. A circle of light. Every person that was present there, not one had doubt that this was the Nur of the Quran. And then this circle of light moved from his heart between his two eyes, and this is where it remained. Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash, for 40 years of his life, that man recited one Quran minimum every day and night. One Quran minimum every day and night, Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash. And now the man's on his deathbed. He's on the verge of leaving this world, and his sister's there sitting beside him. And when she saw her brother, now the time has come. The angels will come. After this, it will be Munkar and Nakir. Man Rabbuk Madinuk Man Hadhu Rajul. What will become of my brother? Love. And tears begin to flow from her eyes, and she begins to cry. My friend, these people were so confident at the time of their death that he turns around and says to his sister, "Okay, my sister, why are you crying?" And then he points to one corner of the room and says, "Your brother sat there and finished the Quran 18,000 times. You have no need to cry." When it came to fasting, you had the likes of Amr ibn Qais al-Mala'i, who fasted for 20 years of his life. Even his family didn't know. And if you think that is some achievement, Dawood ibn Abi Hind, he doubled that, and he fasted for 40 years of his life. 40 years of his life in such a manner, with such sincerity, that his own family members did not even know that he was fasting. Why? Because in the narration it is mentioned that this man was a silk dealer. Every day when he would leave from home, he would take his part lunch. And on the way, he would meet the fuqara, and he would give it a sadaqah. And he would return in the evening, and he would make iftar with his family. His family would think that he's eaten in the day with the marketeers. And the marketeers every day would think that this man goes home and eats. And he managed to keep this a secret for 40 years, and he fasted like this. The likes of Nafisa, she would fast by day, and she would prostrate before the Almighty Allah by night. And it was once said to her, "Kyo Nafisa, take it easy upon yourself. Why are you putting yourself through so much trouble and exerting yourself?" And she would turn around and say to the people, "That I see a barrier before me, and only the faizin, the successful ones, will be able to cross this barrier. And as a result, I do what I do." She's on her deathbed, and even on that day, she was fasting. And people are sitting next to her, and they are now forcing her to break her fast because of the difficulty that she was experiencing. And she turns around and says to them, "I have been begging the Almighty Allah for the last 30 years, and this was my dua. Yo Allah, I beg you, when you send the angel to take my soul, send him on the day in which I am fasting for you. And today you are telling me to break my fast. Hada la yakun. This is something that can never happen." And she leaves the world reciting the verses of the Quran. Kulli mamma fis samawati wal ard kullillah. Say, "For whom is all that which is in the heavens and the earth?" Say, "It is for Allah and Allah alone, who has taken upon himself to be merciful." Leaving the world reciting these verses of the Quran. When it came to prayer, standing before the Almighty Allah in prayer, taking from our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who himself would stand in prayer for so long that the blessed feet of Rasulullah tawarramat qadama, the blessed feet of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would begin to swell. And so many tears would flow from the eyes of Rasulullah that not only would he, not only his blessed beard become wet, he would even dampen the earth on which he would prostrate. And when the Sahaba would see him in this condition, exerting himself, and that his blessed beard is wet, even the earth is wet, having mercy for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would ask, Ya Rasulullah, قَدْ غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Oh, Ya Rasulullah, you are second to Allah. Your status is such that you have no sin. Allah has forgiven everything. Why do you exert yourself? Why do you worship Allah so much? He would turn around and say to his beloved companions, if that is the case, that Allah has honored Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he is second to the Almighty Allah, and Allah has freed his sins, أَفَلَا أَكُونَ أَبْدًا شُكُورًا. Should I not then be a grateful slave and worship Allah even more because of the status that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me? Taking this from our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were ummatis of Rasulullah, the likes of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, Sayyid al-Tabi'een. Never mind missing a prayer, my friends. For 50 years of his life, this man did not miss Takbir-e-Ula. 50 years of his life, not only did he not miss Takbir-e-Ula, for 50 years of his life, he did not see the back of any man in prayer. And the only way you can do that is if you're standing in the first saf. 50 years of his life, Abad ibn Bashir is standing before the Almighty Allah in prayer. He's keeping on watch on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the enemy makes him out. And arrows now begin to pierce his body. And whilst the arrows are piercing his body and he's bleeding heavily, he keeps on standing before the Almighty Allah. And as the arrows hit them, hits him, he takes them out one by one, but he does not break his prayer. And he continues reading as blood is gushing from his blessed body. It is only when the thought crosses his mind that his death may jeopardize the safety of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Only after this thought does he break his prayer. The likes of Urwa has had his left knee amputated, and he's had it amputated while he was awake, while he was conscious. Even on that night, the man stood up for his tahajjud and stood for hours on end before the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The likes of Khubayb is sent to the gallows to be executed, and they ask him for his last wish. And he says to the kuffar, he allow me to offer two rakats. Allow me to speak with my creator. He offers his two rakats. And then he says to them, O kafiro, had it not been for the fear that you people think that Khubayb is afraid of death, I would have asked you to allow me to offer another two rakats so I could converse and speak with my creator. Rabi was paralyzed, but even then he would ask to be carried to the masjid. And the people were saying to him, Oh Rabi, you are ma'zoor, you're an invalid. You don't have to come to the masjid. Allah has given you ijazat. Allah has given you permission to read at home. And he would turn around to the people and say, indeed what you're saying is correct. Allah has given me permission, but I can hear the caller call out, Hayya al-salah, hayya al-falah. Come to falah, come to success. And one should respond to that, to this call, even if he has to crawl on his feet. Thabit al-Bunani, never mind praying in this world. This was the dua of the man, that he would pray to the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he would ask the Almighty Allah, Wallah, I beg you, if you allow anyone to pray inside his grave, I beg you, allow me to pray inside my grave. What type of a person do you think he was, that he's asking the Almighty Allah to allow him to pray inside his grave? Because he'd come over the hadith of Rasulullah in the night of Mi'raj, when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw the likes of Musa standing before the Almighty Allah and praying inside his grave. He'd come across that. This was his desire. How do you think, what type of a life do you think he lived? You had Mu'adha al-Adawiyah. First night of marriage, when you and I are probably on seventh heaven, she and her husband, she wakes up her husband, and they both stand before Sila ibn Ashyam, and Mu'adha al-Adawiyah spend the entire night, first night, standing before the Almighty Allah in prayer and thanking him for his blessings. Every night Mu'adha al-Adawiyah, at the time of during the night, that this thought would cross her mind, okay, tonight is my last night, and it is so possible that I will leave this world and meet my creator. And when this thought would cross her mind, after fulfilling the rights of her husband, she would spend the entire night in worship. When it came to seeking knowledge, Where will the Ummah find people with such zeal? The likes of Sayyidina Abu Ayyub Al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He traveled all the way from Madinah al-Munawwara, hundreds of miles to Egypt, just for the sake of one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's traveled days on end. And now when he gets to Egypt and he meets Sayyidina Uqba, the person who was relating this hadith of Rasulullah, Sayyidina Uqba sees the companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he embraces him. And then he asks, Ma ja'a bika ya Aba Ayyub? Oh Abu Ayyub, what brings you all the way from Madinah to Munawwara? And he responds, one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what brings me. And out of all the people that directly heard it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only you and I remain alive. And the hadith was with regards to concealing the faults of a believer. Okay, whoever conceals the faults of a believer in this world, Allah will conceal his faults in the next world. He relates that hadith to him. Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu responds, Sadaq, you have spoken the truth. This is exactly how I heard Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam relate the hadith. The man does not even get off his horse. My friends, after hearing this hadith of Rasulullah, he turns his mount and he heads back to Madinah al-Munawwara. You had the likes of Ibn al-Qasim, who stayed at the feet of Malik for 17 years. 17 years, Ibn al-Qasim stayed at the feet of Malik just to acquire the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's now with the great Malik, the Imam of Madinah al-Munawwara. And hadith from Misr come. And amongst these hadith is a young man whose face is covered. And he comes to the gathering of the great Imam Malik. And he greets him, Assalamu alaikum, and Imam Malik responds. And then he asks Imam Malik, is Ibn al-Qasim amongst you? Ibn al-Qasim was pointed out for this young man. In the gathering, this young man then comes and he kisses the forehead of Ibn al-Qasim. Ibn al-Qasim did not even know that this person that was kissing his forehead, this young man, was none other than his own flesh and blood. Why? Because when Ibn al-Qasim left, he left 17 years ago. And he left in such a state that his wife was expecting. This was the first time that he saw his son after 17 years in the gathering of the great Imam Malik. You had the likes of Baqi ibn Makhlid al-Qurtubi, the Spaniard scholar, who remained absent from his house twice. The first time he remained absent was a period of 14 years. And the second time he remained absent was a period of 20 years. In total, he spent 34 years traveling from Spain, and he traveled on foot. And he covered thousands and thousands of miles. He walked from Spain all the way to Hijaz, Saudi Arabia and Iraq. And he spent 34 years acquiring the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So much so that on many occasions with regards to him, it is mentioned that he had to sell his trousers just so that he could buy paper, and he lived upon cabbage leaves which people would throw away just to sustain himself. If you think that is some achievement, then wait till you hear about the great Hafiz ibn Manda, rahimahullah, Hafizul Hadith. He left his home, my young friends. Many of you here are probably 20 years of age. He left his home for the sake of hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the age of 20. When do you think the great Hafiz ibn Manda returned home? 65 years of age is when he returned home. 45 years the man spent away from his family just for the sake of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The great Shafi'i, for 16 years the great Shafi'i sustained himself on dates. And he would only eat as much dates that he needed to survive. He could not afford paper, so he would write on leather and on bone. The great Yahya ibn Ma'in, Imam al-Jarh wa Ta'dil, he inherited 1 million dirhams. Every single penny that he inherited from his father, he spent acquiring the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So much so, on one occasion, he had to sell his own slippers just so that he could buy some paper. The great Imam Yusuf, he did not even attend the burial of his own son. He offered his janazah, but he did not attend the burial of his own son, just like the great Hafiz al-Mundhiri. Imam Abu Yusuf did not attend the burial of his son in case he missed the lecture of Imam Abu Hanifa. And as a result, they excelled. The same Yahya ibn Ma'in says, I witnessed the day in which I wrote with my own hands a million hadith. Who can forget the great Imam al-Bukhari and what he achieved? Comes to Baghdad, all the masters of hadith are present, and now they want to test this young man whose fame now runs throughout the Muslim world. And they take 100 hadith and they give them to 10 different people, 10 hadith each. And they mix all the chains and the matan, the text of the hadith. And they relate it before this Imam Bukhari to test him. And they relate to him one by one. They come and they relate 10 hadith. Imam Bukhari has just heard these hadiths the first time. First listening. He listens to all 100. First listening, he recites all 100 of them as they were recited to him with the mistakes, and then he recites all 100 as they should be correctly. He says, this is what you said, it was incorrect, it should be like this. And he did this with all 100, even though he just heard them once. Imam Firyabi, when he came to Baghdad, you had 30,000 people that were sitting in his lecture. In those days when there were no speakers, 30,000 people sitting in his hadith lecture. And sometimes there were 70,000 people. 70,000 people. Look at the passion for the deen. Look at the passion for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And sometimes not only the humankind would present themselves, even the jinn kind would be present. And from the top of their heads, they would write books. Abu Bakr ibn al-Bari, 30 books. The great Ibn Shaheen, 300 books. The great Suyuti, 500 books. What to say of Dhahabi, Ibn Hajr al-Asqalani, Badruddin al-Aini, Imam Nawawi, and so forth.